Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. This is a school and it is not a church. And neither are we affiliated with any church or religious organization. This school is a non-profit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh, our Elohim, and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating through our eternity until this present day. Now, this school is a result of a divine vision and revelation given to our founder, Dr. Henry Clifford Kinley, in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. And we're incorporated in the state of California in the year 1958. Since that time, we have established branch schools throughout the United States, Canada, and some other foreign countries. The Ontario Branch School was established in May of 1988. This time, I'd like to introduce to you the school officials. The dean of the Ontario Branch School is Dr. Joe Williams. Now, in this school, we used to teach by the true and originated title for the Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been properly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit manifested in or out of a physical body is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and God is many. We now know that each Lord must have a name and each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title. But unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Now, Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in their alphabet that would produce the sound made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1400 years after the Messiah's death. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible rendering for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Now, Christ is a title just like Lord and God. Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state is incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolized in this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose a cloud to symbolize himself because a cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. Now, we draw this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right within himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super corporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. Now this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifested himself in a physical body and walked the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah. The world calls him Jesus Christ. Now there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading the preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in the school, we teach Elohim.
A divine pattern of the universe.
He's called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. Now, the Yahweh Elohim led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt. He called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. He instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. This pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. In the school, we show proof that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of the threefold tabernacle pattern, and that absolutely nothing escapes this pattern. Now, the 10 primary constitutional objectives or aims of this tour is followed. Number one is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as it really is and actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah, without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. Seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons, operating a mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man can be saved, saving the name of Yahshua as Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace, and our slogan is speak the truth. This morning we heard a prayer by Dr. Samuel Salas. Our scripture lesson is Matthew, third chapter. And our scripture reading will be Dr. Kenneth Wayne Kindsmith. And we'll have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It's time of prayer. Thank you, Almighty Yahweh, for all the blessings you pour into ourselves. This beautiful teaching you give us in the late days to the founder and the Clifford Finley is something amazing. We are so happy to have this teaching, who tell us how the gospel had to be taught around the world. Whoever listened to this teaching, put attention, because it's a salvation in there. I say all those things, and you only sign name Yahshua the Messiah. Let us all say,
Hallelujah.
Change, taught me how to change.
John the Immerser preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, "Repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is near at hand. For this is he that was spoken of by the prophet Isaiah, saying, The voice of one crying in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of Yahweh, make straight in the desert a highway for our Elohim." And the same John has his raiment of camel's hair and a leathern girdle about his loins, and his food was locusts and wild honey. Then went out to him Jerusalem and all Judea and all the region round about Jordan, and were immersed by him in Jordan, confessing their sins. But when he saw many of the Pharisees and Sadducees come to his immersion, he said unto them, O generation of vipers, who hath warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Bring forth therefore fruits meant for repentance. And think not to say within yourselves, We have Abraham as our father. For I say unto you, that Yahweh is able of these stones to raise up children unto Abraham. And now also the axe is laid unto the root of the trees. Therefore every tree which bringeth not forth good fruit is hewn down and cast into the fire. I indeed immerse you with water unto repentance, but he that cometh after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to bear. He shall immerse you with the Holy Spirit and with fire. whose fan is in his hand, and he would thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire. Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him. But John forbade him, saying, I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me? And Yahshua answered and said unto him, Permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh to fulfill all righteousness. Then he permitted him. Yahshua, when he was immersed, went up straightway out of the water, and lo, the heavens were opened unto him. And he saw the Spirit of Yahweh descending like a dove and lighting upon him. And lo, a voice from heaven saying, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. That was Matthew, the third of the cross name.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Okay, thank you. And before we get on to today's lectures, I want to...
Hospitality? Bring hospitality.
Man, I got strong and blank. Okay, we have visitors, first-time visitors this morning. I'm going to have them with us. Jabari Akai?
Akil.
Okay, friend of... Siobhan. It's not on the tape. And next one is Jury Williams. Is that right, Jury?
No, it's pronounced Zuri Williams. Zuri Williams.
Sorry.
Zuri Williams.
Yeah, Zuri Williams. Okay. Yeah. Zuri. Zuri. Okay, Williams. A friend of.
Daryl.
You gotta excuse Daryl. Me, Daryl. Okay. Boy. Okay, our first speaker this morning, we're going to continue with our winter series of lectures. And our first speaker will be Dr. Christopher Williams. His topic is Joshua, Yahshua.
It's a pleasure and honor to have an opportunity to speak on some of the things that I've come to learn and know in this great gospel. And to first-time visitors, I hope and trust that something that's set on this floor today to stimulate your mind and continue to make you want to come and visit and study with us again. And if you missed it, I want you to understand a couple things. This is not a church, and this is a school. And we call this the School of the Highest Learning. Because this school is called the Institute of Divine Metaphysical Research. Institute meaning school. Metaphysical means beyond the physical. We're transcending this physical plane and talking about esoteric secrets that are laid down in the Bible. And we're here and we're researching what's already been searched. So that means we're not just taking what man has come up with, or what's just written in that Bible. We have researched everything in the Bible, science, every study of man that you can think of to prove the existence of Yahweh for ourselves. And that's what we're here to do. And today's topic is Joshua and Yahshua. So before we get into that, I want to kind of set the stage so that some of these people who are new to the school can kind of understand where we're coming from. So, in the beginning of today's lecture, we had the moderation. And the moderation talked about the names of the Heavenly Father, the Word of Son, and the Holy Spirit, which were written in Hebrew, Greek, and Latin. Now, if you know anything about our Heavenly Father, the true name is Yahweh. And if you look at the symbols here, this is Hebrew, okay? And Hebrews write from left to right, and we read from right to left.
That's right.
So when you see this is actually YHWH, because they don't have any consonants any vowels in their language. They only have consonants. So when you read this, if we were to read this in English, we couldn't pronounce this name.
Mm-hmm.
And so the Hebrews have what they call diacritical marks to make vowel sounds. And that's how they pronounce this name, Yahweh. Now, you could say this is a, people will say this is a Hebrew name, but I read English, and it's pronounced the same way. Just like if you heard, if you were right, read, if you was to hear your name in another language, it would pronounce it the way you give it. And that's how you pronounce your name. Now, Yahweh means, has a meaning. Like, names in Hebrew always have a meaning.
That's right.
But Yahweh means he who breathes into existence, whatever exists. He who brings into existence whatever exists. That means if it exists, it exists by the will of Yahweh.
Right.
And so we have to understand that the name is important. And that's the name of the Father. Likewise, we have the name of the Word or Son, because if you've ever heard, read in the Bible how it talks about the Word came unto me saying, you didn't see the Bible coming to you, coming to people in the Spirit. It was His Son, okay? And when we say that, we talk about Elohim as a super incorporeal being. That means this is an incorporeal, it means a spiritual being appearing, likened to a man.
Right.
Now, Yahweh is not a man, but He took on that shape and form because that's how men can relate to Yahweh. Because Yahweh is really pure spirit. And spirit is nothing more than these divine attributes of intelligence, wisdom and knowledge, beauty, love and justice, foundation, power and strength. This is what spirit is. You can't see these attributes with your natural physical eyes,
right.
But Yahweh has taken something physical to show something spiritual. Please give me Romans 1:19 and 20, and then also get John 5 and 39, and hold Matthew 5 and 17. And while you're at it, please get 1 Corinthians 15 and 1. But give me Romans 1:19 and 20 first.
Romans 1:19 and 20. Because that which may be known of Yahweh is manifest in them.
So you can know something about your Creator Yahweh. And it's manifested in them. Read.
For Yahweh has showed it unto them.
And now that word manifest means to make known. Okay? So something that can be known of Yahweh is manifest in them. Read again.
Okay. For the invisible things of Him.
Now the invisible things of Him are these divine attributes, these spiritual principles. Read.
From the creation of the world are clearly seen.
Read.
Being understood by the things that are made.
So how can we understand Yahweh's invisible principles by the things that are made?
Right.
Now if you were here last week, Will talked about the hydrological cycle. And how that these attributes are made manifest in the physical plane so you can understand them. You can't see them in the spiritual, but you can understand them in the physical.
Right.
And we took that, how that water is in the world. 70% water is salty. Mm-hmm. If you go in the oceans, you can't drink that water. But because Yahweh so loved the world, He took the power of the sun,
right.
The S-U-N, which is a type in the shadow of the S-O-N, to take that water and evaporate it. Mm-hmm. And that's an intelligent process.
Mm-hmm.
And it took someone with great wisdom to develop a process that is intelligent and having the knowledge of the elements and what it takes to feed and sustain an ecosystem to do this, to create this process. Likewise, He did it out of the love,
right.
For the love that He has for His Son, or His Son, sons, and it's a beautiful process how that evaporation from the Son, the power that just evaporates that water so high to a point to the clouds, becomes a cloud, and then it just rains down on the earth indiscriminately, showing that there's justice. Everyone gets the benefit from the beautiful parch, from the beautiful ecosystem that's been developed.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the foundation of our ecosystem. Because if this didn't happen, there's no life on this planet. Because
right.
Everyone, every creature needs water to stay alive.
Right?
And it takes a lot of strength of the sun to do that. So the invisible things of Him from the creation of the world are clearly seen. And that is just one operation in the earth that Yahweh uses to prove his existence. And one of the other creations that he made was the man. But we're going to get to that in a minute. Okay? So that is the word coming unto you saying, showing the invisible things of him. And then he also took on a physical form as Yahshua the Messiah. And we'll get to it later about how I can prove that. But Yahshua is the Son, is the Holy Spirit made manifest in the physical body as the Messiah.
Right.
Okay? Now, you can see there's some similarities in Yahweh and Yahshua. But you don't see any similarities in Lord God and Jesus Christ.
Right.
Now, if you look, if you look at the etymology of the word, it is English origin. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, you have the House of Lords, and everyone has a name in the House of Lords. You got Lord Bartholomew, Lord Matthew, Lord James. But the Lord is a title. Mm-hmm. And you don't put the in front of a proper name.
That's right.
Just common English. And then this here is German origin. And every god has a name. If you are a fan of Marvel's Avengers, Thor is a god. Yeah. But Thor is his name. Okay? And then Zeus is a god. But Zeus is his name. And if you take a look at this name, Jesus, it is Babylonian, Greek, and then Christ is Hindu from Hare Krishna, meaning the anointed one. So we have an English, German, Babylonian, Greek, Hindu God, which just doesn't make sense for a Hebrew nation. Make sense out of that. So that is the name. Now we want to qualify that name, Yahshua. Now there's no J in the English language there's no J in the Hebrew language, Greek or Latin, to this day. But yet, we have many people in the world, billions of people, praising the name of Jesus. Now, and back then, when the Messiah was on the cross, his name was written in Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. And above his cross, it said, Yahshua Nashas, King of the Jews, written in Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. So if there's no J to this day, the question is, what name was written on that cross? That is a question that I need someone to answer. But we here answer that question. And it's Yahshua the Messiah. Now, you might say, well, why do we call them Jews? Well, when you see J's, it was actually Y's. They were called Yehudis. Right?
That's correct.
And it was Jerusalem. Okay? So where you see a J, there was usually a Y. And that J is a little over 400 years old in the English language. And that was in place, and it was put right behind the eye, because it looks similar. It's just an eye with a hook on the end.
Mm.
Okay? So, that is done. So, I talked about this just so we can kind of qualify this name, Yahshua, because that's what we're talking about today. Now, if you ever read the Bible, everything is talking about Yahshua, Messiah, in some shape, form, or fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So, before we get into those scriptures, please give me Isaiah 8 and 20. So I want to talk about the scriptures.
Isaiah 8 and 20.
Mm-hmm.
To the law and to the testimony.
Now the law, which is the first five books of the Bible, and that is credited to Moses, who wrote those books, from Genesis, Exodus, Numbers, Leviticus, and Deuteronomy. Read.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
And when we say there's no light, that means there's no understanding in them. If they don't speak according to the scriptures, there's no understanding in them.
Right.
Now the scriptures at that time when they were writing, because there's no writings of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Paul's epistles, nothing. John the Revelator, no one wrote until after the Messiah's death. So the only scriptures they had was Genesis to Malachi. Okay? So these are what we need to use to prove what we're talking about down here. And if anyone talks to you about Yah and his purpose, if they are not proving it according to the scriptures, then they are just making up stories, half-truths, and lies. It is not my words. That is the scripture that we just read. Okay? So, you know, the founder of this school said, don't believe me because I said it. He said, make me prove it unto your satisfaction.
Right.
And that means they have to prove it according to the scriptures. Now, I'm going to attempt to prove to you how that if you that the Messiah was here in those scriptures, because he talks about it in the New Testament, or the fulfillment of the book. So let's get into the meat of this thing and see if we can do just that. Now, I have a couple scriptures you're holding, correct?
Right.
Please give me Matthew 5:17. Now, Yahshua has a job to do. Now, he wasn't here to set up any Christian way of life. And if you believe that, that is just a lie. Because he tells you in the scriptures himself what he was here to do.
Right.
Now, the Messiah, he did many things on this earth. And the one most famous thing that everyone knows and can speak to is this right here, how that the Messiah died on the cross. And everyone can tell you, oh, the Messiah came to save us all, which is true and correct. But his job was bigger than that.
That's right.
Now, if you think he was here just to die, that was the culmination of everything he was trying to do.
Very good.
Read.
Think not that I am come to destroy the law or the prophets.
Now, we just talked about what the law and the prophets was, right? Read.
I am not come to destroy, but to fulfill.
Now, let's qualify what that word means. Because he says, not come to destroy, but to fulfill. That word is a very big and important word. Fulfill. Can we read that in the dictionary, please?
Fulfill, mm-hmm. A verb, bring to completion or reality, achieve or realize something desired, promised, or predicted, carry out a task as required, pledged, or expected. You want synonyms?
Mm-hmm.
Achieve, attain, realize, actualize, make happen, succeed in, bring to completion,
mm-hmm.
Bring to fruition,
right.
Satisfy.
I think in the actual dictionary.
She's reading out it.
Yeah.
Merriam-Webster says, English language learner's definition of fulfill.
I think she has it. Can you read your units?
Okay. To put into effect,
mm-hmm.
To bring to an end.
Okay. Perfect. That's
to measure up to. Mm-hmm.
It says to bring to an end. Keep reading.
To measure up to,
mm-hmm.
To convert into reality.
Oh, right there. Read.
To develop the full potentialities.
Read.
And the rest of them are synonyms.
Okay.
Satisfy.
Do we have perform in there?
Oh, perform.
No. Does it say to perform?
To make, feel, form. No.
Okay. So in order to fulfill something.
Synonym, see, perform.
Right. Mm-hmm. So to perform. So in order for the Messiah to fulfill the law and the prophets, he had to complete them and perform them. So that means he had to perform 4,000 years of people, places, and things.
That's right.
And the only way he could do that was to actually institute it. Because everyone here that at least has a vehicle had to perform some car payments to keep their car. Because if you don't fulfill your obligation to that contract, you're going to lose your ride. In fact, I saw someone lose their ride last night, and that was just because they weren't fulfilling their obligation, right? So you establish a contract, which I believe the Messiah did, and now it's time for him to complete it by performing it, okay? So his mission was not to destroy the law and the prophets, but to fulfill them.
Right.
So now we got to talk about, well, we already talked about what the law and the prophets are, but we're here to prove the existence of Yahshua in the beginning of the Bible. Okay? So, give me 3 in Matthew 3 and 13 again, because I want to reiterate the fact. And then somebody get ready to read John 5 and 36, not 39. Sorry.
Okay, Matthew 3:13.
Correct.
Then cometh Yahshua from Galilee to Jordan unto John to be baptized of him.
Now we have this poorly illustrated right here on this chart, how that Yahshua and John the Baptist are here in the Jordan River. Now, we don't have it pictorially illustrated completely. We just took the two main characters in the writings. But I have you know that there was a multitude of people out here witnessing to this. Because John's mission was to baptize all people that needed to repent. So if you came to John, you came to him and you said, I could not fulfill my obligation of that contract of the law that was given to us. And that means you were dead. Because right. under the law was if you sinned under this law, you had to die. Mm-hmm. Well, since you didn't want to die, you had to offer up a sacrifice to do so.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Now, that sacrifice had to be not some pigeon or something that you could care less of. It was your best offering, your best lamb, your best ram, whatever it was, it had to be the one you loved the most.
Yeah.
Had to die in your place. Innocent blood had to be spilled. And the principle is, in order for something to live, something has to die.
Mm-hmm. Right?
We talk about it, we do it daily in our lives now. Last time I checked, anyone that consumes meat, that meat was alive.
Mm-hmm.
And in order for you to live, it had to die. Now, vegetarians might try to come up and say, well, my plants weren't alive. No, plants have life too. There are male and female plants in this, just no different. And they die just like you do, like animals do. Because when you cut them from the root, it is dead. So the principle remains the same, but the manifestation changes. Okay? Read.
But John forbade him, saying,
uh-huh.
I have need to be baptized of thee, and comest thou to me?
Read.
And Yahshua answered, said unto him,
uh-huh.
Permit it to be so now, for thus it becometh us to fulfill all righteousness.
It said to fulfill all righteousness. So that's that word, fulfill again. They're performing something. Right? So the Messiah is getting baptized under John. And call me crazy, but part of the Old Testament, baptism was part of the law. Everyone had to be baptized under the law of Moses. Right? So when the Messiah fulfilled the act of baptism, that was him performing something that was established.
Right.
Right. Now, we have to show how the Messiah was here instituting this thing in order for us to show that he's fulfilling this thing. Okay? So, get me John 5:36.
But I have a greater witness than that of John.
Now this is the Messiah talking to the scribes and the Pharisees, and they're challenging him. Now he's talking to them. This is him himself talking. Read.
For the works which the Father hath given me to finish.
Now he didn't say the institute, did he?
No.
He said these are the works that the Father has given me to finish. Read.
The same works I do, and they bear witness of me,
all right,
that the Father hath sent me.
Right.
And the Father himself, which hath sent me, hath borne witness of me.
Read.
Ye have neither heard his voice at any time, nor seen his shape.
Right.
And ye have not his word abiding in you.
Read.
For whom hath he sent, him ye believe not.
Right.
You search the scriptures.
And now he said, now you search the scriptures. And we've been talking about what the scriptures are, because that's all they had. Read.
You search the scriptures, for in them ye think ye have eternal life.
Read.
And they are they which testify of me.
Now this is something crazy. He is nothing but 30 years old talking to these men, talking about they are testifying of me. Read.
But ye will not come to me, that ye might have life.
Now you're not going to come to the Messiah himself that you're going to have life. Read.
I receive not honor from men.
Now we have a lot of people that think that they need to receive honor from men. I'm talking about in this day and age. Donald Trump requires honor from men every day in his life, or he cannot sustain his ego.
Yeah.
Does that sound about right?
That's not about right.
We have a lot of people Bible thumping on TV receiving honor from men.
Swagger thumping.
There you go. That's a word.
We have. They have names. It used to be Freddie Price. We have Joel Osteen, T.D. Jakes. All these Bible thumpers. Look at me. Look at me. I got the word. Read, right? That's what they say. But the Messiah is saying, hey, I will receive honor from you. I don't need it. Read.
But I know you, mm-hmm. that ye not have the love of Elohim in you.
Now, how did he know this? Because his mission was to die and resurrect. And his spirit had to pour out in the hearts and minds of men. And he had not done it yet. So they didn't have the love in them that was required to do this. Read.
I am come in my Father's name.
Now, we talked about this earlier, how he came in his Father's name. This is the Messiah speaking, saying that he comes in his Father's name. Now, I didn't talk about it because I wanted to wait for this part. Now, Yahshua means Yahweh is salvation. Yah is the contractual form of Yahweh, meaning that Yahweh here, and Shua means salvation, that Yahweh is salvation. His name depicts his mission.
That's right. Right.
Mystery hidden in a man, right?
Yeah.
Now, Yahweh is both masculine and feminine within himself. He doesn't have to go outside of himself to create or procreate or get anyone else to create a creation. Not like we do. We require a female or male people to come together to create offspring. Now, Yahweh himself is both masculine and feminine. Now, to prove that, I want you to get Genesis, second chapter. Get where he's taking the woman out of the man. When he created, no, excuse me. 1:26. Genesis 1:26. Read.
1:26. And Elohim said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness. And let them rule over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the heavens.
Okay. So he said, let us make man after our image and after our likeness.
Right.
Now that us is both, they're talking to himself, both male and female, creating man. Now give the second chapter how he takes the woman out of the man.
18. And Yahweh Elohim caused a deep sleep to fall upon the man, and he slept. And he took the rib and womb and closed up the flesh and stood thereof.
So we have this pictorially illustrated here, how he took the man and caused a deep sleep and took the womb out of the man. And how we have a womb man. And we call that woman. Right? Contraction form of womb man. And so when he was created, he said, let us create man after our image and after our likeness. Creating him both male and female. And then he took the woman out of the man.
Here's the bigger one.
Oh. Go ahead.
Bring it over. 12.
Play 12. Just 12. Perfect. The director is directing right now.
It's a bigger picture.
No, I got to follow the director. Hey, listen, I'm mad at you. You're right. So we have Adam here with this deep sleep, and he takes the womb out of the man, creating a woman. Showing that he was both male and female within himself.
Right.
Because we talked about in Romans, taking something invisible, Yahweh being both male and female, and creating a physical creation to show how it's pointing to him. Right? Now, I just wanted to prove that point, that Yahweh is both male and female within himself. Right? Mm-hmm. Now, the question is, how is Yahshua showing the same oneness that Yahweh has? Now, this is a contracted form of Yahweh, right? Now, we just showed how Adam had the woman hidden in the man. Mm-hmm. Likewise, the way is hidden in the Yah, showing that Yahweh is salvation. The same principle being proven with his name. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Right.
That's what we're talking about down here. So everything that's happening is not happening by happenstance. He wasn't just lucky. This was divine intelligence in operation. Okay? Now we're still in John, right?
Yes.
Go ahead and read.
John 5:43.
Read.
I am come in my Father's name,
uh-huh.
and ye receive me not.
Mm-hmm.
Let another come in his own name, him ye will receive.
Now, everyone received Jesus Christ. Without a doubt. No one wants to give up Jesus Christ. Even though we can prove, and we have proven, that Yahshua is the name of the Messiah. You can read in the dictionary, you can pull up an encyclopedia, and for you millennials, that is a book that talks about really intelligent things. And people in way back when used to read this to get knowledge. And the encyclopedia, which is a dead tool, it's a great tool of references. It teaches you a lot about things you thought you knew that you don't know. Look up at Yahweh in the encyclopedia, and you have a wealth of knowledge at your disposal. Read.
How can ye believe me, which receive honor from of another, and seek not the honor that cometh from Elohim only?
Mm-hmm.
Do not think that I will accuse you to the Father.
Read.
There is one that accuseth you,
uh-oh,
even Moses, in whom ye trust.
Now Moses was the man. He was the man to these people. Moses could do no wrong. So he says, I'm not going to accuse you to the Father. There's one that accuses you, even Moses, in whom you trust, because the law of Moses is what they live by. So Moses could do no wrong. But Moses was just a type and shadow of things to come. He was the moon. But Yahshua is the sun. And the moon gets its light from the sun. Right? So everyone thought that the law of Moses was everything. But Yahshua was here to do something way better than condemn you to a law. Laws do nothing more than make sin more exceedingly sinful.
That's right.
And listen, it's hard following laws and rules, right? We don't have laws and rules that we give ourselves. There was a time when I was a kid, I got punished for something. I did something stupid like I always do, right? And so one of my punishments was, you got to go to bed at 7 o'clock. Now, doing like after daylight savings time, you know, it's over. It's like, no big deal. It gets dark at 5, whatever. It's time to go to sleep. But during the summertime, that's rough. You know what I mean? You know, my kid, my friends outside playing, laughing outside of my house. They never play outside of my house. But during this time, they know I'm Monday. Hey, listen, that was smart. He's like, man, I'm going to get you. I said, you like going outside? Well, you can't go no more. Take your butt to bed. Right? And so after I was released from punishment, I said, hey, Dad, I'm going to start doing this forever. I feel good. Got a lot of sleep, man. Day one, I was up at 10. And he said, you can't even keep your own law. But that was the truth. We do it all the time. Oh, I'm not going to eat any carbs. Next you know, you're eating bread. Right? I'm not gonna talk and text anymore. Next you know, you'll be talking and texting me right now. Right? We do it all the time. We have laws that we're here to abide by, and we break them all the time. Likewise, the Israelites couldn't keep that law. They sinned all the time. These people were sacrificing at a rate that we could not even keep up with, because sin was abundant. And no one could keep that law. So that necessitated Yahweh to send them a Savior. But he knew that from the beginning.
That's right.
See, the purpose of the law was to prove to everyone that they needed a Savior.
Mm-hmm.
Everyone needs to be saved. Everyone has demons, me included. I'm the first one I'm talking about. No one is free of demons and things that they're dealing with. And it's not. And the purpose of this lecture is not to talk about some secret that is laid down in the mystery in the Bible. That is just the icing on the cake. It is so you can see the reality that, hey, you need to be saved just like everyone else. And when you start to put your faith in Yahshua and believe in him, then you can find salvation. And your burdens are no longer a burden anymore,
right?
Because you're giving it to him. That's the point. But let's get to the main grade, because this is getting good. Now, we said that. Did we finish in here?
Not yet.
Read on.
Do not think that I have come to accuse you of the Father. Mm-hmm. There is one that accuseth you, even Moses, in whom ye trust.
Right.
For had ye believed Moses,
right,
ye would have believed me,
mm,
for he wrote of me.
That's impossible, in no way. I don't believe it. But I don't believe it. There's no way. Moses wrote about Yahshua the Messiah, or Jesus.
Yeah.
There's no way.
Great. So
Read.
But if ye believe not his writings, how shall ye believe my words?
So they marveled at the fact that he said, hey, Moses wrote about me. And they're saying, there's no way, you're not even 40 years old yet. What are you talking about? How did Moses talk about a man that's only 30 years old today, back then? Well, we're going to have to prove that. So we said Moses wrote of him. We're going to do that. But before we get to that, get me, you know what, let's do that. Exodus 3 and 1. And you know there's a particular scripture that I want you to start getting. So you might as well get Exodus 24:9-10. Just hold your finger there because we're going to use that. And then we'll get to the other ones. But let's start with Exodus 3 and 1. Now this is the beginning of the Bible. Will talked about this last week. Did a great job talking about this last week. As soon as you get to it, read.
Exodus 3 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law,
uh-huh.
priest of Midian.
Uh-huh.
And he led the flock to the backside of the desert
uh-huh.
and came to the mountain of Elohim, even to Horeb.
So now we have this totally illustrated right here. Now this chart that I'm using right now is called the Moses chart. Right? This is the Moses chart, or better yet, this is a chart that takes your picture. Okay? Now this chart talks about is showing how that the Israelites were down here in Egypt, and we have it totally illustrated that they're in darkness, symbolizing of death. Right? And then we have them in the wilderness, and then we have Canaan's land, which is a type and shadow of heaven or heavenly things. And then we have the days of creation and Moses being in the mount. Also, we have John on the Isle of Patmos showing what he saw in the same vision that Moses saw. But that's for another time in a lecture, but please come back to get that. It's good stuff. Now, this is what we have pictorially illustrated. So right here, you have Yahweh, Moses at the burning bush. Read.
And the angel of Yahweh appeared unto him in a flame of fire
uh-huh.
out of the midst of the bush.
Read.
And he looked,
mm-hmm.
and behold, the bush was fire, and the bush was not consumed.
Now, in the wilderness, it's dry. And you know that if you have anything dry with fire around, it's just going to light up like an inferno. But yet, nothing was being consumed by this fire. So you got to know that this was a vision happening in Moses' mind. Read.
And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight,
mm-hmm.
that the bush does not burn.
Uh-huh.
And when Yahweh saw that he turned aside to see,
uh-huh.
Elohim called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said,
uh-huh.
Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I.
So now he's calling Moses by his name. Read.
And he said, draw not thy hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet,
mm-hmm.
for the place wherein thou standest is holy ground.
Read.
Moreover, he said, uh-huh. I am the Elohim of thy father,
uh-huh.
the Elohim of Abraham,
uh-huh.
the Elohim of Isaac,
Read.
And the Elohim of Jacob.
Now these aren't just some run-of-the-mill people. These are the patriarchs of his forefathers. These are his forefathers. No different than George Washington, you know, Abraham Lincoln. These are people that are big deal. That's a big deal to them. Read.
And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon Elohim.
Right.
And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, and mm-hmm. I know their sorrows.
So he's saying, I have surely seen the affliction of thy people. Now, when people read this, they just think because Yahweh is ever present, he's just looking in heaven, he's looking at everything like it's a movie mm-hmm. on HBO.
Right.
Uh-huh.
But that is just not so.
That's right.
Read.
I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
Back on up. Read that again slowly so that everyone can see this, because
yeah.
I don't want you to read over this. We read it last week and we read over it because he was getting to a different point. Wait, read that again, slowly.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians,
mm-hmm.
and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land.
Back up and read the scripture before that, please.
7. And Yahweh said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which
read.
Are in Egypt,
uh-huh.
and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters,
uh-huh.
for I know their sorrow.
Read.
And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians.
He said, I am come down to deliver them.
That's right.
So he didn't just say, I heard it because I was in the heaven,
right.
listening from above. I'm right here with them suffering.
That's right.
I know their sorrows.
Mm-hmm.
because he has come down to deliver him out of the hands of the Egyptian, because he's right there with him.
Right. Good.
Read. And to bring them up out of that land,
mm-hmm.
unto a good land,
mm-hmm.
and a large unto a land flowing with milk and honey.
Okay, jump down to 13, please. Now, read this out of King James Version, because I just want to pull out this point. Read.
13, and Moses said unto Elohim, behold,
King James Version.
Oh, King James Version.
I want to prove a point about the name while I'm here. Just in case anyone didn't catch the point, I want to hit it home. Read.
King James Version 3:13.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses said unto God,
mm-hmm.
behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, mm-hmm. and shall say unto them,
mm-hmm.
the God of your fathers has sent me unto you,
mm-hmm.
and they shall say to me, what is his name?
Now you have Moses talking to God, asking God for a name.
Right.
Now what sense does that make? If God is the name
right.
of God,
right.
why is Moses asking God for a name to give these Israelites in Egypt?
Right.
In Egypt, they were a polytheistic society.
That's right.
Meaning they had many gods. They had a sun god, a sky god, a river god, the locust god. Everything was a god. Pharaoh was a god. And all of them had names. Amun-Ra is a god. But that was the name of that god. So the question is, what god is coming to them now to deliver them out of the hands of the Egyptians? That's the question. And you got Moses talking to God, asking about this name. Now, read that out of the whole name Bible so it makes more sense.
And what is his name?
Read it. Start at 3:13, please.
3:13. And Moses said unto Elohim,
mm-hmm.
behold, when I come unto the children of Israel, I shall say unto them,
mm-hmm.
the Elohim of your fathers has sent me unto you.
Uh-huh.
And they shall say to me, what is his name?
Read.
And what shall I say unto them?
Read.
And Elohim said unto Moses, Ea, Asher, Ea.
Now, in the King James Version, it says, I am that I am.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this is the correctly translated version, meaning Eyah, Asher, Eyah. Now, you see that Yah, because it has meaning,
mm-hmm.
points Yahweh. I will be. What I will to be is what was. It was how it's really translated. Now, if you take I am that I am, that's a very limited statement. Popeye the Sailor Man says, I am that I am, that's all I am. I'm Popeye the Sailor Man. I should love that cartoon. Right? But Yahweh says, I will be what I will to be.
Mm-hmm.
I will be the sun. I will be the moon. I will be the earth. I will be the man.
Mm-hmm.
I will be a man appearing and coming down to suffer just like the Israelites at the age of 30.
That's right.
Because I will it to be. That's what that means. That's how you qualify Yahweh in the present. Because if you think that he is what he is, and that's all he is, well, right now, all I am is this burning bush. That's as good as it's going to get. But that's not what we're talking about. We're talking about an ever-present Yahweh, a never-changing Yahweh that will be whatever he chooses to be because he is spirit materialized, and spirit can be anything. All right? So that's what we're talking about. Not a limited Yahweh, but an unlimited Yahweh. Read.
Thus shalt I say unto the children of Israel, I will be, and sent me unto you. And Elohim said moreover unto Moses,
mm-hmm.
Thus shalt thou say unto the children of Israel, Yahweh, the Elohim of your fathers,
uh-huh.
the Elohim of Abraham.
Now it said Yahweh. Now in the King James Version, I believe it says, the Lord God.
That's right.
Now you still have, if you truly believe that Lord God and Jesus Christ are the names of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit, and listen, if that's what you believe, that's what got you this far, stick with it. But if you got Moses asking God for a name, and he's using Lord, the Lord God, which is two titles connected to each other, to prove the existence of Yahweh the Father, there's something wrong here. And it requires you to go back and look at what you've been believing for this long. Mm-hmm. And I know it's a hard thing to do, to let go of something that you believe all your life.
Right.
But I'm not here to make you give up what you believe in. All I'm presenting to you is the truth and letting it speak for itself.
Right.
I'm not here to do anything other than teach what I've been shown.
Right.
And listen, I heard the same thing for the first time, and I'm like, there's no way! What are you talking about? And as a kid, I challenged the same concept. Because every tub has to sit on its own bottom. There is no one that's going to save you but Yahshua himself. And it's only if you believe in Yahshua. And if you do not believe, that is on you. But you have to deal with that with Yahweh, not me. All I can do is present the truth. The revealing will be done by Yahweh himself. Okay? So, we have the Lord God, or Yahweh, as the name that was given to them by the one that came down to deliver them. Right? Now, give me, shucks, where is that?
Exodus 24.
Huh? 6 and 3. Exodus 6 and 3, please.
Exodus 6 and 3. And I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob, as El Shaddai.
Right.
But by my name, Yahweh, was I not known to them.
Right.
And I
go ahead, read.
And I have also established my covenant with them.
Right.
To give them the land of Canaan, and the land of their pilgrimage, wherein there were strangers.
Right. So and here we have Yahweh talking to them, telling them, they didn't know me by Yahweh, but they knew me as El Shaddai, meaning Almighty Provider.
Right.
Okay? And El is what we're looking for. And if you notice, you got names like Ezekiel, Jeremiah. All these things are pointing to Yahweh and his purpose. Okay? So we want to, but we're here to prove the existence of Yahshua in the scriptures, because he said he wrote of them. Now we just read how Yahweh said, "I have come down to deliver them." Right. Now, the one that came down to deliver them was, you know what? Let's get it. Exodus 24:9-10, please. This is after the Israelites came out of the land of Egypt. Actually, no, 24:9. Read. Excuse me, 24:1. I apologize.
24:1.
Yes.
And he said unto Moses, "Come up unto Yahweh, thou and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel, and worship ye afar off. And Moses alone shall come near Yahweh, but they shall not come nigh, neither shall the people go up with him." And Moses came and told the people all the words of Yahweh and all the judgments. And all the people answered with one voice and said, "All the words which Yahweh has said will we do."
Get to 9 and 10, please.
Then went up Moses and Aaron, Nadab and Abihu, and 70 of the elders of Israel.
Read.
And they saw the Elohim of Israel, and there was under his feet, as it were, a paved work of a sapphire stone.
Read. And if you look at this, it kind of looks like the globe here, right? Read.
And as it were, the body of heaven in its clearness.
So we have 74 people that saw God, or Elohim, having feet, body, and hands. So we saw something like unto a man. That's what we're reading here, correct?
Right.
Read.
And upon the noble of the children of Israel, he laid not his hand. Also they saw Elohim and did eat and drink.
Read.
And Yahweh said unto Moses, "Come up to me into the mount and be there."
So we have Yahweh saying, "Hey, Moses, you come up a little further," because they're at the plateau of the mount. But he said, "Moses, I want you to come on up and come see me." Read.
"And I will give thee table of stone."
Read.
"And a law and commandment which I have written, that thou mayest teach them."
Read.
"And Moses rose up, and his minister Joshua."
Joshua. That's who's down here appearing up to him being evilly entreated. So his minister Joshua, which is correctly rendered Yahshua, because there was no J back then. Right? Right. We're just proving the point, hitting home, hitting the mystery. And that's how, and that's the funny thing. Y'all, the best place to hide is in front of someone's face.
Right.
Because no one's looking, right? You're looking for everything outside of you, but you're not going to look right in front of you. Because there's no way you can hide in front of me. And that's exactly what y'all has been doing this entire time. Because these scriptures have not changed. This has been the same script that I've been reading for the last 30-something years. It has not changed. Read.
And Moses rose up in his minister Joshua.
Now that just don't make sense. If Yahweh said, come up alone and see me, but now you got Joshua rising up with him, that just don't make sense. How's that possible? Well, let me prove it. Get me Exodus 33 and can you remember my Bible with?
7:11
Yes, 7:11
And Yahweh spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend.
That's 11, right? Give me 7:3
7:7
And Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp.
There you go.
So we have a tent back here at the backside of the mount.
That's
read.
Right.
Okay. Afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation.
Right.
And it came to pass that everyone which sought Yahweh went out into the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without the camp.
So if you wanted to see Yahweh and talk to him, you had to go to this tent. Now, nobody wanted to go talk to Yahweh, so Moses did all the talking, just so you know. Read.
And it came to pass, when Moses went out unto the tabernacle, that all the people stood up and stood every man at his tent door.
Because this was something to see. Because when you gotta go talk to Yahweh, who's gonna go talk to Yahweh about that? We do that all the time. When the authority's outside, everybody wanna come out and see what's going on. What are you coming here for? Right? Read.
And looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle.
Okay.
And it came to pass, as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended.
So we had this cloud that was above here.
There you go.
And it descended above this tabernacle. Read.
And stood at the door of the meeting tent.
Read.
And Yahweh talked with Moses.
Mm.
And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door.
Read.
And all the people rose up and worshipped every man in his tent door.
Read.
And Yahweh spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speaketh unto his friend.
Read.
And he turned again into the camp.
Mm-hmm.
But his servant Joshua.
Uh-oh. His servant who?
Joshua.
His servant who? His servant who?
Joshua.
Joshua. Read.
The son of Nun.
Mm.
A young man.
Mm-hmm.
Departed not out of the meeting tent.
Read.
And Moses said unto Yahweh, see thou sayest unto me, bring up this people.
So you got Moses speaking to Yahshua, or Yahweh, right? Because Yahweh come down.
Right.
To deliver them out of the hands of Egyptians, which he did. So when he's down, he's talking about Yahshua, right? So he said John, he wrote of me. Call me crazy, but I think we read about how he wrote of him, right? Now, so we got, and just so I can qualify this, I need you to get, okay, go ahead, read.
And Moses said unto Yahweh, see, thou sayest unto me, bring up this people, and thou hast not let me know whom thou wilt send with me. Yet thou hast said, I know thee by name, and thou hast also found grace in my sight.
Read.
Now therefore I pray thee, if I have found grace in thy sight, show me now thy way, that I may know thee, that I may find grace in thy sight, and consider that this nation is thy people.
Read.
And he said, my presence shall go with thee, and I will give thee rest.
Okay, so I'm looking for a scripture where he's attached to the tribe of Ephraim. I know it's in Numbers.
13:8.
There you go. Numbers 13:8, that's what I'm looking for. Now, this is Moses writing out the genealogies of the Israelites, and I want you to pay close attention to this one.
Numbers 13:8.
Mm-hmm.
Of the tribe of Ephraim, Oshea, the son of Nun.
Okay, and that was a tribe that was attached to Joseph, in place of Joseph, as Joseph's son. And here you have Ephraim, which is part of the kingship tribe, and it's the same tribe that Yahshua the Messiah later on is going to be born out of. Right? Mm-hmm. So we got Joshua, the son of Nun, Nun after the flesh, pointing and starting something with the Israelites, no different than Yahshua the Messiah being attached to the same tribe, showing that he's the same man. Okay? Now, that may not be enough for some of you, because we gotta continue talking about this thing, because I want to make sure that when you leave here, you don't leave thinking, I think he just made that up. Now, get me...
16 verse. 16, six, number 16 verse.
Read. 16 verse.
These are the names of the men which Moses sent to survey out the land.
Mm-hmm.
And Moses called Hoshea, the son of Nun, Yahshua.
Mm.
Degree.
That's good enough. That's good enough. Now, I need 1 Corinthians 10:1. But before you get me that, I want you to get me 1 Corinthians 15:1.
1 Corinthians 15:1.
Read.
Moreover, brethren.
Now that means, on top of what I've already told you, I'm going to give you a little bit more. Read.
I declare unto you the glad tidings.
We declare unto you the gospel, because gospel means good news. Read.
Which I have preached unto you, which also ye have received.
Now this is Paul talking right now. Read.
And wherein ye stand.
Uh-huh.
By which also ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I have preached unto you.
Read.
Unless ye have believed in vain.
Uh-huh.
For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
You want 10:1. That's what you want, Chris.
10:1?
10th chapter.
You're right. Okay. 10:1.
1 Corinthians 10:1.
I apologize.
Okay. Moreover, brethren,
read.
I would not that you should be ignorant,
read.
How that all our fathers was under the cloud and all passed through the sea.
Now we talked about that cloud. It was a pillar. Yahweh was a pillar of cloud by day and a fiery cloud by night to light the way. And they followed that cloud from Egypt to the Red Sea, and they followed that cloud in the wilderness. Read.
And were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea.
He was baptized in the cloud and in the sea. Read.
And did all eat the same spiritual food.
Mm-hmm.
And did all drink the same spiritual drink.
Read.
For they drank of that spiritual rock that went with them.
Uh-huh.
And that rock was the Messiah.
So now we got Paul talking about how the Messiah was back there with the Israelites as well. Read.
But with many of them, Yahweh was not well pleased.
Okay, we're good there.
Yeah.
So we got Moses talking about the Messiah being back there. We got Paul talking about the Messiah being back there, showing how Yahshua was present with the Israelites, instituting everything that you see in the Bible. Now, what I want to show... Let me make sure I got it right. I'm going to read it. Let's go. Go back to 15:1. Not 15:1. Go back to 15:3, because you read over something. You left out a word. Read.
1 Corinthians 15:3. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Yahshua died for our sins according to the scriptures.
Read.
And that he was buried, and that he was again, and he rose again the third day.
Now, go ahead.
According to the scriptures.
Now he says that he died, and he was buried, and rose again the third day. Now that word again implies that he rose before. He died, buried, and resurrected before. Now I gotta prove that according to the scriptures. So I need you to get down there, Joshua, as a 24 and, what was it, 29?
Yeah.
24 and 29.
Joshua 24:29.
Read.
And it came to pass after these things that Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old.
Read.
And they buried him in the border of his inheritance, and to
Tenasserah,
which is in Mount Ephraim, on the north side of the hill of Gash. And Israel served Yahweh all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders that overlived Joshua.
So now we have Joshua, who was in the wilderness for 40 years with them, cross over, fight 33 battles, two on this side, 31 on that side. And they took over the land of Canaan that was promised to them, okay? And then he died. So all those battles, never died, never had any, you know, scratches on him. Because he had to be without spot and without blemish. God stayed true to his principles, right? And he died, being 110 years old. Now, we got him a living, we get him dying, and he's buried in Tenasserah, right?
Right.
Now we got to show him resurrecting. Because that's the point. Because everyone on this earth believe that reads this Bible thinks that the Messiah is coming back again to deliver us to heaven. And I'm here to tell you he's already done that.
Right.
Because you do not have to die to go to heaven. Likewise, you don't have to die to go to hell. Because there's some people on this earth that are in hell right now.
That's right.
And likewise, there's some people that are just living in heaven. As they walk on this earth. Because heaven is a state of consciousness. And when you understand that principle, you have some peace. You ain't worried about dying. Because you can have your inheritance now. Read the next chapter.
Judges.
No, yeah, Judges. Second chapter.
Judges, second chapter.
Oh, wait, no. Judges.
First chapter.
First chapter, I apologize.
Judges 1 and 1.
Mm-hmm.
Now, after the death of Joshua, it came to pass that the children of Israel asked Yahweh, saying, who shall go up against the Canaanites first to fight against them?
Now, do me a favor. When you see the word, the letter I, emphasize that letter, please, and read slowly. Read.
And Yahweh said, Judah shall go up. Behold, I have delivered the land unto his hand.
Mm-hmm.
And Judah said unto Simeon, his brother, come up with me into my lot, that we may fight against the Canaanites, and I likewise will go with thee into thy lot. So Simeon went with him, and Judah went up.
No, you know, so that was the death. So after the Joshua's death, he said that, hey, they're talking to Joshua. They're talking to Yahweh, saying, hey, who's going to come up and fight against the Israelites? Now go to the second chapter.
Second one?
Yeah, this is the same conversation. We just in the next chapter. Read.
Judges 2 and 1. And an angel of Yahweh came up from Gilgal.
There you go.
And invoked him and said, I made you to go up out of Egypt and have brought you unto the land which I swore unto your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you.
Read.
And ye shall make no language.
No league.
No league with the inhabitants of this land.
Read.
And ye shall throw down their altars. But ye have not obeyed my voice. Why have ye done this?
Read.
Wherefore, I also said, I will not drive them out from before you, but they shall be as a thorns in your sides.
Read.
And their idols shall be a snare unto you.
Read.
And it came to pass, when the angel of Yahweh spake these words unto all the children of Israel, that the people lifted up their voices and wept.
Read.
And they called the name of the place
Bochim,
and thy sacrifice,
and they
sacrificed there unto Yahweh.
Read.
And when Joshua had let the people go,
now they said, now Joshua had let the people go. So now the angel of Yahweh is telling them, I did this, I did that, and now the angel of Yahweh is now named Yahshua,
and letting them go, read,
the children of Israel went every man into his inheritance to possess the land.
Okay, read.
And the people served Yahweh all the days of Yahshua, and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua, Yahshua, who had seen all the great works of Yahweh that he did for Israel.
Read.
And Yahshua, the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old.
So now, we have Joshua, who died and has been buried, and had to come back to inspire the people one last time to go take the land that was theirs to begin with. That is Joshua being shown that he's really Yahshua, being written of by Moses and the prophets, like he said he was. And when we read how that Paul's talking about he's buried and died and rose again the third day, showing that he instituted it, now he's fulfilling it. Because we talked about how Yahshua's mission was to fulfill, and how that this death was nothing more than just icing on the cake. Because at the end of this thing, he says, I'm what? Finished. And all he did was fulfill from Genesis to Malachi. And if you want to get all those fulfillment items, you got to come back to get more. Because this is a school and not a church. And we're here to do nothing more than to teach of the esoteric secret that Yahweh has given us. And the curriculum here is Elohim, the archetype or original pattern of the universe. And that's all we're talking about down here. And I hope and trust you got something that was set on this floor to establish you to come back here and worship and preach and learn with us another day. Excuse me?
It's a ghost.
Well, there's some other principles that I think someone's going to bring out. My job was to prove Joshua is Joshua.
You did.
And I think I did that. Okay. Thank you very much. I appreciate the opportunity and the time.
Thank you for that. Our next speaker will be Joel Williams. You want to speak?
I'll do it.
Okay. Next speaker will be Dr. Will Williams. Joshua was one of the same. And that was something that it blew my mind, because I grew up in church. And I was always taught that this one here came to set an example for me to follow.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And I could never understand the connection between the so-called New Testament and the Old Testament, because they said, well, this guy here, this is God's son, you know, right? So, I mean, I could never, it just didn't make sense until they explained to me about the fulfillment. And then explained to me how this one was back here instituting the law that he came and fulfilled.
Very good.
See? Now, that's something that a lot of people really can't understand. I mean, you know, fail to see that. And our founder used to say this. He said that the mystery of Yahweh being manifested back here as Joshua, son of Nun, is probably one of the greatest mysteries Yahweh ever perpetrated on mankind. Mm-hmm. Okay. Now, the first speaker went through a lot of stuff, and yeah, I thought he did good, you know, but because it's really an exhaustive subject. It really is.
But I'm going to try to go back and try to accentuate maybe a couple of things he brought up. Okay, let me start with Isaiah 8:20. Let's start there. Because there's a principle here that you have to understand about the Bible. All right?
Isaiah 8:20.
Mm-hmm.
To the law and to the testimony, if they speak not according to this word, mm-hmm. it is because there is no light in them.
Okay, now, to the law and to the testimony. Now, it was brought out, but I'm going to accentuate this. The law is the first five books of the Bible, the Old Testament. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It was written by Moses. Now, the world knows that. Theologians know that. Okay. Now, the prophecy or the testimony, which is the prophecy, is drawn out from what Moses wrote. That simply means this. Anybody that came along, like Isaiah, Daniel, Ezekiel, Jeremiah, whatever they had to say in terms of prophecy or testimony, it had to echo what Moses wrote. It had to echo what was written in the first five books of the Bible.
Right.
Okay? It's drawn out from that. Okay? Let me give you an example. Since we're in Isaiah 9 and 6.
For unto us a child is born.
Uh-huh.
Unto us a son is given.
Mm-hmm.
And the government shall be upon his shoulder. And his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, the Mighty El, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace.
Okay. Now, here's Isaiah. He's making a prophecy, and most people pretty much know this scripture. It's a very familiar scripture. Because we just got through going through Christmas. And they quote this scripture, right? A child shall be born, and so forth, so forth. But read it again, the first couple of lines.
For unto us a child is born.
Uh-huh.
Unto us a son is given.
Uh-huh.
And the government shall be upon his shoulders.
Now it says the government shall be upon his shoulders. Now Isaiah is making a prophecy about this. He said, now the government is going to be on his shoulders. Now for Isaiah to say that the government is going to be upon his shoulders, he has to reference something back in the five books of the Bible that Moses wrote about somebody upon whom the government was put on his shoulders. Do you understand the point I'm making? For him to say, well, this is what's going to happen. About the Messiah. The Messiah, when he comes, the government shall be on his shoulders. Well, for that to happen, that meant that for somebody in the past, in what Moses wrote, Moses had to have written about somebody upon whom the government was put on his shoulders.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Get it?
Mm-hmm.
Now, let's find out who that might be. I think it's in Genesis.
It's on Genesis.
See that Moses wrote, there was a book he wrote, Genesis, let's see.
40.
I'm sorry?
41:40?
Yeah. Let's start with 38. Now, before you read, let me preface it. All right? Now, this person whom we're going to read about, see, he was a man named Joseph. Now, I'm sure some of you have heard of Joseph. He was the dreamer, right? He had dreams up here when he was up in his father's land, saying that he had a dream once of 12 sheaves of wheat, letting sheaves bow down to his sheaf. And the sun, moon, and the stars, 12 stars, 11 stars, bow down to his star. The sun and the moon representing his father and mother. And they were like, we got to bow down to you too. And see, not understanding that Joseph is drawn out as a type. See, the whole Bible is pointing to Yahshua Messiah in some aspect or another. So now here we got Joseph, he's being drawn out. And he's going to be sent down here because his brother's going to sell him into bondage, all right? But that's according to a purpose, right? He's going to be down here, and he was a dreamer. He ended up being in Pharaoh's prison because he worked for the captain of the executioner, and his wife kept hitting on it. To the point that she grabbed his clothes, and the only way he could get away was to get out of his clothes to get out. But she used that to say, well, see, this guy, he came in trying to, rape me and all. See, here's his clothes here, framing him, But while he was there, he interpreted the dreams of the Pharaoh's butler and the baker.
Right.
See, and just to cut the story short, He told the baker, he said, what's going to happen to you? And he said, you're going to get executed. I said, well, he's going to have your head because you messed up in his eyesight. But to the butler, he told me, he said, Pharaoh's going to restore your position. But when he do, put in a good word for me. Yeah. All right? So it came to pass. The baker came. He got hanged. The butler got restored to his position. But he forgot about Joseph. And Joseph languished for 2 years. But during that time, Pharaoh had a dream that disturbed him. He had a dream of 7 fat cows and 7 lean cows that ate the 7 fat cows. And another dream of 7 full, ears of wheat. And then 7 lean, ears ate, devoured the good ones. And he didn't know. He didn't know what it meant. His psychic friends and advisors didn't know what it meant.
Right.
All right. And so they were just perplexed by it. And then the butler, all of a sudden, he remembered, because it was Yahweh that caused it, that brought it back to his remembrance. Sire, when you put me in prison, I met a Hebrew down there who was an interpreter of dreams. And he seemed to be pretty good at it, because he interpreted the baker's dream and my dream, and it came to pass. Perhaps he can help you with this. So they got Joseph out of prison, cleaned him up, shaved him up, presented him before Pharaoh, and he interpreted Pharaoh's dream. Basically, he told him, I said, look, this is what's going to happen. And said, the 7 fat cows, the 7, fat ears of corn, what it means is you're going to have 7 years of plenty, 7 years of good harvest, followed by 7 years of lean famine that's so severe that it will affect the world. Now, if you were a smart man, when the 7 years of plenty come about, store it away so that when the 7 lean years come, you'll be prepared. And so now, this is where we're at, right here in
Genesis
41:38. 37.
And the thing was good in the eye of Pharaoh.
And now Pharaoh liked that idea. So now that's a prudent plan. Save up during the good years, and so we'll be prepared. That's a good plan. Keep going.
And in the eyes of all his servants.
And everybody agreed. That's a good plan. That's, go ahead.
And Pharaoh said unto his servants, can we find such a one as this is, a man who has the spirit of Elohim in
him? Now, can we find somebody of whom he's talking about, Joseph, has the spirit of Elohim in him?
Very good.
Read.
And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, for as much as Elohim has showed thee all this, there is none so discreet and wise as thou art.
Mm-hmm.
Thou shalt be over my house, and according unto thy words shall all my people be ruled.
In other words, he's putting the government on his shoulders.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Get it? He's a type of the Messiah, because he said that the spirit of Elohim in him, and now he's putting the government on his shoulders. Read.
Only in the throne will I be greater than thou. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, see, I have set thee over all the land of Egypt.
God said, now you're the ruler. See, except for me, you're the ruler. Everybody got to come to you and see what's going on. See, read.
And Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand and put it upon Joseph's hand and arrayed him in vestures of fine linen and put a gold chain about his neck. And he made him to ride in the second chariot which he had. And they cried before him, bowed the knee.
He says, bow the knee. In other words, you give this man obeisance. He's riding in the chair. Bow the knee, everybody. The whole multitude, they bow the knee. For Joseph, read.
And he made him ruler over all the land of Egypt. And Pharaoh said unto Joseph, I am Pharaoh, and without thee shall no man lift up his hand or foot in all the land of Egypt.
Okay, jump down to 53, quickly.
And the 7 years of plenteousness that was in the land of Egypt were ended. And the 7 years of famine began to come, according as Joseph had said. And the famine was in all the land, but in all the land of Egypt there was bread.
In other words, the famine was worldwide. I'm just letting you know this. This famine was not just limited to Egypt, but it was worldwide. Go ahead.
And the 7 years of famine began to come, according as Joseph had said, and the famine was all in all the land. Mm-hmm. But in all the land of Egypt, there was bread.
Now, those people that were starving elsewhere, they had to come to Egypt to get some bread. And they brought their most valuable objects. They brought gold, silver, linen, silk, pearls, rubies, to pay for bread,
right.
For food.
Yeah.
Okay? That's how Egypt got rich down here, because you read later about treasure cities they built.
Come on.
I didn't say treasure neighborhoods.
Come on.
Yeah.
Or treasure building. Treasure cities. Okay? See? So much stuff that they had, you know, a street. You know, one street was Gold Street.
Yeah, come on.
Another street was Silver Street.
Mm-hmm.
Next street was Ruby Street.
There you go.
Emerald Street. You know, Linen Street. Silk Street. Because on that street, the houses and the warehouse, that's all they had on there.
Yeah.
Were treasure cities. Read.
And when all the land of Egypt was famished, the people cried to Pharaoh for bread.
Now, Pharaoh was a god. The first people told you Pharaoh was a god. So they went to their god. God, help us. Feed us. And what did God tell them?
The people cried to Pharaoh for bread, and Pharaoh said unto all the Egyptians, go into Joseph.
Go see Joseph. Go see Joseph. This is God. This is their God talking to them. They went to God. God feed us. And God said, go see Joseph.
And the famine was over all the face of the earth. And Joseph opened all of the storehouses and sold unto the Egyptians. And the famine waxed sore in the land of Egypt.
I see now, in other words, now, the first speaker talked about the name. And he talked about, before, look, let me say something about that name, Yahweh. Moses is the first creature,
right,
human or angel, in whom Yahweh revealed his name to. Prior to that, nobody knew his name. Not even Michael and Gabriel, who's on the throne. See, on Ark of the Covenant, they didn't know until Yahweh told it to Moses. But prior to that, he was known as El Shaddai.
There you go.
See, El Shaddai is simply a contraction of the name of the title Elohim. And it simply means the Almighty Provider. Now that's what Joseph was.
Okay.
We just read it. He was the one who opened up the storehouses and fed them. He was El Shaddai in a very physical sense to those people. So he's a type of that. He's a representative of that, of the Messiah. We just read about how the government was put on his shoulders. See? It's all pointing to Yahshua. But now, what do I want to get to? I know what I want, but before I get there, let me get this in here. Genesis 48 and 8.
And Israel beheld Joseph's son and said, who are these?
Now here's Joseph, a big man, right? So now, you know, he's rich and all. But, you know, he's got son, and his father, Jacob. He's dying. And so now he brings his sons to Jacob, right, for blessing. Because it's a tradition. You know, the blessing of the right hand.
Right.
Blessing of the right hand. The firstborn. Because, see, a lot of people don't realize it. Because people will read the story. And they'll say, Joseph, he was one out of 12 sons that Jacob had. In fact, he was the 11th son born unto Jacob. Right, and so people would tend to look at that and say, well, he's the youngest, you know, like the baby, so to speak. But when you really understand it, Jacob had two wives,
right.
Yeah.
Leah and Rachel.
Right.
The majority of the children he had was by Leah, yeah, and her maidservants, whereas he only had two children by Rachel. Joseph was one of them. Joseph was the firstborn son of Rachel.
Right.
So in Jacob's eyesight, he was a firstborn son. Even though he had other sons before him and all, but Joseph was the one he really loved. Because of Rachel. Because he loved Rachel. And that was the firstborn son. So therefore that's why he treated Joseph so, you know, gave him a coat of many rainbows and all that kind. His brother said, why Pops, you know, why you like him so much? Well, see, there's a reason, because that's his firstborn son by the woman he loved. He had you by the woman, you know, because he had you by contract. He had to work 7 years, and then work seven more years to get Rachel. Be thankful he didn't sell you. sell you off somewhere, you know. But, you know, we take the sons, go to work and all, but we...
And Joseph said unto his father, they are my sons.
These are my sons that I've had since I've been down here in Egypt. Read.
Whom Elohim has given me in this place.
Uh-huh.
And he said, bring them, I pray thee, unto me,
uh-huh.
and I will bless them.
Now you bring them to me, and I will bless them, just like I did you, and my father did me, and so forth and so on. Read.
Now the eyes of Israel were dim for
uh-huh.
age.
In other words, he couldn't see that well. Okay, read.
So that he could not see. And he brought them near unto him, and he kissed them and embraced them.
Uh-huh.
And Israel said unto Joseph, I had not hoped to see thy face,
mm-hmm.
and lo, Elohim has showed me also thy seed.
Mm-hmm.
And Joseph brought them out from between his knees,
uh-huh.
and he bowed himself with his face to the earth.
Now Joseph is bowing, and he's presenting his children to Jacob. Read.
And Joseph took them both, Ephraim in his right hand towards Israel's left hand.
Now Ephraim, who was the younger, toward Israel or Jacob's left hand. In other words, you know, Joseph is bowing down, he's pushing his children to his father. Ephraim, the younger, on the left, to his left hand. Read.
And Manasseh in his left hand towards Israel's right hand.
Toward Israel's right hand, because Manasseh was the elder. So he wanted Manasseh to receive the blessing of the elder, or the right hand.
Mm-hmm.
The blessing of the elder. Alright? That's what it's supposed to be like. So technically, he's supposed to stretch his hands out, put his hand on Ephraim's head, put his hand on Manasseh's head, mm-hmm. and give a blessing.
Right.
Technically, that's what in Joseph's mind, this is what's supposed to happen. But read.
And brought them near unto him. And Israel stretched out his right hand
uh-huh.
and laid it upon Ephraim's head.
Read.
Who was the younger?
Read.
And his left hand upon Manasseh's head,
uh-huh.
guiding his hand with it,
uh-huh.
for Manasseh was the firstborn.
Read.
And he blessed Joseph uh-huh. and said, Elohim, before whom my father Abraham and Isaac did walk, the Elohim which fed me all my life long
mm-hmm.
until this day,
uh-huh.
the angel which redeemed me from all evil,
mm-hmm.
bless the lads. And let my name be named on them, and the name of my fathers, Abraham and Isaac, and let them swarm as fish swarm in the midst of the earth.
Read.
And when Joseph saw
Now Joseph, mind you, he's bowing before his father, and he's not seeing this, because his head is down, he's getting obedience, while Jacob is saying all this. He's not looking at this. Read.
And when Joseph saw that his father laid his right hand upon the head of Ephraim,
he looked up and he was like, wait a minute, read.
It displeased him.
Uh-huh.
And he held up his father's hand to remove it from Ephraim's head.
And he grabbed the man's hand, grabbed his father's hand, said, no, take it off of this head, put it on this one. Read.
Unto Manasseh's head. And Joseph said unto his father, not so, my father.
So not so. That's wrong. Put it over here. This is the firstborn. Read.
For this is the firstborn.
Uh-huh.
Put thy right hand upon his head.
Read.
And his father refused
uh-huh.
and said, I know it, my son.
I know it. I know what I'm doing.
He also shall become a people.
That's how
the
Jewish say, shut up. I know what I'm doing. I've heard that a lot from Jews. Shut up. I know what I'm doing. Read.
And he also shall become a people,
uh-huh.
and also shall be great.
Uh-huh.
But his younger brother shall be greater than he.
His younger brother shall be greater. Read.
And his seed shall become a fullness of nations.
Okay, now see why he said that. Now the first speaker went through about the numbers about Joshua being attached to the tribe of Ephraim. I'm showing you why. See, because Ephraim and Manasseh took the place of Joseph. See, well, actually, technically, Manasseh took the place of Joseph. That's why you never hear about a tribe of Joseph.
Yeah.
It was supplanted by the tribe of Manasseh,
right.
who was the firstborn son of Joseph.
Right.
Now, the tribe of Levi, what happened to them was they got relegated to this tabernacle.
That's right.
Operating this tabernacle.
That's right.
And Ephraim took their place as a son. That's why they became a tribe, and they received a plot of land up here. See, technically, you can say it was 13 tribes that went through here, because there was 12 tribes, and the 13th tribe would be the tribe of Levi operating the tabernacle, but they received no inheritance, because their inheritance was the tabernacle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Now, Genesis 50 and 19.
And Joseph said unto them, fear not, for am I in the place of Elohim?
But he fear not, for am I in the place of Elohim? Yes. El Shaddai, he's a type. He was in the place. He was the almighty provider as far as they were concerned in Egypt. See, as far as the world was concerned, because they had to come there to buy grain. All right? Now, keep reading.
But as for you, he thought evil against me.
He's talking to his brothers now, because they were the ones they didn't understand. And see, now you thought evil against me. What you did is, you know, you sold me in a pit, you know, sold me, you know, kept me in a pit, sold me to the Midianites, that, you know, they took me to Egypt. You thought evil against me, but see, but it was the purpose of Yahweh. See, that was him working this thing out so that, to what?
But Elohim made it good unto me. Made it unto good to bring to pass, as to this day, to save such people alive. Mm-hmm. Now therefore, fear ye not, I will nourish you and your little ones, and he comfort them.
All right, now jump down to
24. And Joseph said unto his brethren, I die.
I see, now he's saying to his brethren, look, I die.
And Elohim will surely visit you.
Elohim will surely visit you.
And bring you out of the land unto the land which ye swear to Abraham, to Isaac, and to Jacob.
Now see, he's telling them right plainly. He said, Elohim will surely visit you. See, I'm just a type. You know, you can look at me to get an idea of what he's going to be like, but he will come, and he himself will visit you, and he himself will take you up out of here. Read.
And Joseph took an oath of the children of Israel, saying, Elohim will surely visit you, and ye shall carry up my bones from hence.
Mm-hmm.
Joseph died, being 110 years old. And they embalmed him, and he was put in a coffin in Egypt.
Now, see, now he died, and he was 110 years old. Why? See, because it's pointing to, let's see, let's get Joshua. Yeah. 24th chapter, 24 and 29. Actually, let's start with 24:21. You get that in there.
Joshua 24:21. And the people said unto Joshua, nay, but we will serve Yahweh. And Joshua said unto the people, you are witnesses against yourselves.
Uh-huh.
You have chosen Yahweh to serve him.
Mm-hmm.
And they said, we are witnesses. Now therefore, put away, said he, the strange idols which are among you, and incline your heart unto Yahweh Elohim of mm-hmm. Israel. And the people said unto Joshua, Yahweh our Elohim.
24 and 1.
And Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem, and called for the elders of Israel, and for their heads, and for their judges, and for their officers. And they presented themselves before Elohim. And Joshua said unto all the people, thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel, your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time.
Dwelt on the other side of the flood. Now that's not talking about the great deluge.
Right.
That's talking about this here. We have a map. This is the Euphrates River, which flooded over every year, you know, bringing down silt from the mountains. Now Abraham dwelt on the other side of that river from Haran. You can read it, we don't have time. He dwelt on the other side of the flood, on the other side of the river Euphrates, and they came across the river and came down into Canaan. Canaan land, okay? Quickly.
And Joshua said unto all the people, thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel.
Now, thus saith Yahweh Elohim of Israel. Now here's Joshua, he's standing in front of the people and he's talking to them, see? Read.
Your fathers dwelt on the other side of the flood in old time, even Terah.
Uh-huh.
The father of Abraham and the father of Nahor, and they served other idols.
Uh-huh.
And I took your father.
And he switches over to first personal. I did this. Read. He's telling them. He's looking at them just like I'm looking at you. And he's saying, I did this.
And I took your father Abraham from the other side of the flood.
Read.
And led him throughout all the land of Canaan and multiplied his seed and gave him Isaac.
Mm-hmm.
And I gave unto
and
Isaac.
I did this. Just keep reading.
And I gave unto Isaac, Jacob, and Esau.
Uh-huh.
And I gave unto Esau Mount Seir.
I did this. He's saying, I. And he's standing there in front of him. I did this. Mm-hmm. He's not just saying, repeat, well, this is what Yahweh said. No, he's standing there like he's saying, look, I did this.
Right.
He's looking at him there. I did this.
To possess it. But Jacob and his children went down into Egypt. I sent Moses also, and Aaron, and I plagued Egypt, according to which I did among them, and afterwards I brought them out.
I did this. See, now jump down to the 29th verse.
29.
And it came to pass after these things that Joshua the son of Nun, the servant of Yahweh, died, being 110 years old.
He was 110 years old. When did we just read where Joseph died?
Mm-hmm.
And he was 110 years old. See, why? Because he was pointing to him.
Right.
110 years old. Quickly get Matthew 17 chapter.
And after 6 days, Yahshua taketh Peter, James, and John his brother, and bringeth them up into a high mountain apart, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and his raiment was white as light. And behold, there appeared unto them Moses and Elias, talking with him.
Mm-hmm.
Then answered Peter and said unto Yahshua, Sire, it is good for us to be here, if thou wilt. Let us make here 3 tabernacles, one for thee, one for Moses, and one for Elias.
Now, why is he saying this? Remember, Yahshua's mission is to fulfill, so he's performing that which was already established. We got Peter, James, and John here. He's going up. They're going up a mountain. Why?
Right.
That echoes Aaron, Nadab, and Abihu.
Because
they saw the Elohim of Israel. Or they saw Joshua, the son of Nun, transfigured in front of Moses. They saw him transfigured here into this form. Just like Peter, James, and John saw him transfigured, Yahshua transfigured here. A tabernacle was mentioned back here. Why? I'd rather tabernacle mentioned here. Because the tabernacle was mentioned back here. Quickly read.
When he yet spake, behold, a bright cloud overshadowed
him. That's a cloud overshadowed. Why?
And behold, a voice out of the cloud.
There was a voice from the cloud. Because there was a cloud overshadowing here, and a voice came out. That's got to be fulfilled here. A cloud got to overshadow them, and a voice come out of the cloud.
Which said, This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Hear you him.
Uh-huh.
And when the disciples heard it, they fell on their face and were sore afraid.
Uh-huh.
And Yahshua came and touched them and said, Arise and be not afraid.
Read quickly.
And when they had lifted up their eyes, they saw no man save Yahshua only.
Uh-huh.
And as they came down from the mountain, Yahshua charged them, saying, Tell the vision to no man until the Son of Man be risen again.
Wait, who? Tell me what? Risen again.
From the dead.
That's him saying that. To be risen again from the dead. Now, for him to be rise again from the dead, that means that he lived before, he died before, he resurrected before.
Right.
Mm. And we showed you that was Joshua. That, now, he's saying that. Because if this was a red letter edition, you know, there would be him saying that. Quickly.
And his disciples asked him, saying, Why then say the scribes that Elias must come first?
Mm-hmm.
And Yahshua answered and said unto them, Elias truly shall first come
uh-huh.
and restore all things.
Uh-huh.
But I say unto you that Elias has come already.
He come already.
And they knew him not.
But they didn't know it was him.
But they have done unto him whatsoever they listed.
They did, because Herod cut off his head. That, you know, read.
Likewise shall also the Son of Man suffer of them.
Mm-hmm.
Then the disciples understood that he spake unto them of John the Baptist.
Of John the Baptist, that was Elias. Because that was in the Old Testament. It was said that Elijah would come before the great and terrible day of Yahweh. Well, he did. He did. Okay? Only got like maybe 5 minutes left. I can't really go through this. But you'll come back.
Right.
And we have videos. You can go and look, you know, and see this stuff in intricate details. But see, the Messiah, see John the Baptist, see John, Joshua son of Nun. Genesis 15:12, and please be fast.
Genesis 15:12, and when the sun was going down, a deep sleep fell upon Abram, and lo, an horror of great darkness fell upon him.
Uh-huh.
And he said unto Abram, Know of a surety that thy seed shall be a stranger in a land that is not theirs,
mm-hmm.
and shall serve them, and they shall afflict them 400 years.
Shall afflict them 400 years. All right. Read quickly.
And also that nation whom they shall serve will I judge, and afterwards shall they come out with great substance.
Now here's the point I'm trying to make. This is when Joshua the son of Nun appeared down here in Egypt,
right.
at the end of 400 years. Galatians 16. Is it? No, Galatians 3:16, I think, yeah.
Galatians 3:16. Now to Abraham and his seed were the promises made.
Uh-huh.
He saith not, and to seeds, plural, but to thy seed singular, which is his Messiah.
Mm-hmm.
And this I say, that the covenant that was confirmed before of Yahweh in his Messiah, the law, which came 430 years after, cannot disannul.
Now see, he says 430 years. Now some people think this is a scribal error. Well, was it 400 years or was it 430 years? And what they don't really realize is this, that Joshua appeared down there at the end of 400 years and he spent 30 years in Egypt. Okay? He spent 30 years in Egypt, 40 years in the wilderness of Sinai with the Israelites, and then 40 years for the conquest of Canaan's land. That's how he ends up being 110 years old. See? The Messiah has to fulfill that quickly. Luke 3, help me out, Joe.
3:22.
Thank you.
And the Holy Spirit descended as a bodily shape, like a dove upon him. And the voice from heaven said, Thou art thy beloved Son, and thee I am well pleased. And Yahshua himself began to be about 30 years of age.
He was 30 years of age when he started his ministry, when he went to John the Baptist to be baptized. See?
Matthew 4, chapter.
Because we said that they were all baptized in the cloud and the sea. So Joshua was 30 years old when he was also baptized in the cloud and in the sea unto Moses. All right? Quickly.
Matthew
4 and 1. Numbers 13,
34. Which one
first?
Matthew.
Either one.
Matthew, Numbers 14, 34.
Matthew.
After the number of the days in which he served in the land, even 40 days, each day for a year.
Now that's called prophetic time. We had that read about the spies, you know, when Joshua was being attached to the tribe of Ephraim, and he was one of the spies that spied out the land. They spied it out for 40 days. Two of them came back with a good report.
Right.
10 came back with a not so great. The people believed the not so great. And so therefore, they were punished a day for a year for the time that they spied out the land. 40 days, a day for a year, they ended up being 40 years in the wilderness. Yahshua's got to fulfill that.
Matthew 4 and 1.
Uh-huh.
Then was Yahshua led up of the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted of the adversary.
Uh-huh.
And after he had fasted 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry.
See, a day for a year. He's fulfilling Israel. He's in the wilderness of Judea 40 days to fulfill the children of Israel being in the wilderness of Sinai for 40 years. A day equaling a year. Okay? All right, now Acts 1 and 2.
3.
3?
1 and 2. Until the day in which he was taken up, after that he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments unto the apostles
and
the chosen, to whom also he showed himself alive after his passion by many infallible proofs, being seen of them 40 days.
40 days.
In the things pertaining to the kingdom of God.
See, that's 140 days. See, that's him fulfilling or performing Joshua, the son of Nun.
Right.
See? Now, give me Pentecost.
And when the day of Acts 2 and 1.
Yeah.
And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, while they were all with one accord in one place, suddenly there came a sound from heaven as a rushing mighty wind.
Now, when did that happen? Now, that happened, that happened 10 days after his ascension. Mm-hmm. Go back and get the ascension, and somebody else get Leviticus 25 and 8. Quickly, I'm out of time.
Acts 11 and 10.
Uh-huh.
And while they looked steadfastly towards heaven as he went up, behold, two men stood beside them in white apparel, which also said, Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven?
Mm-hmm.
This saying also, which is taken up from heaven unto heaven, taken up from you to heaven, shall also in like manner, as he hath been seen.
Wait a minute, read it again. Come on.
And Yahshua, which was taken up from heaven unto you into heaven, shall also in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven.
Okay, now that was at the end of the 40 days he ascended into heaven. 10 days later, he poured out the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost. Why is that? Leviticus 25 and 8.
And thou shalt number 7 Sabbaths of years unto thee, 7 times 7 years, and of the space of the 7 Sabbaths of years shall be unto thee 49 years. Then shall thou cause the trumpet of the Jubilee to sound on the 10th day of the 7th month.
Mm-hmm.
In the Day of Atonement shall you make the trumpet sound throughout all your land. And you shall hallow the 50th year.
It's the 50th year, see, that they were going to do this. After every 50 years, there would be a jubilee. They could not do it here in the wilderness. They were only here for 40 years.
Right.
See, so once they got into Canaan's land, 50 years after they got into Canaan's land, that's when they celebrated their first jubilee. Or 10 years after the death of Joshua. Because he fought for 40 years. He died. 10 years later, they served their first jubilee. So 10 years later, see, you add that on to Joshua, that'd be 120. But see, 10 days later, the day of Pentecost comes. That's 120. That's fulfilling. Moses, because Moses died at 120. That's Joshua picking up Moses. Noah preached for 120 years. That's Yahshua performing or picking up Noah. You see what I'm saying? See, the three kings of Israel, the united monarchy, Saul, David, and Solomon, they ruled 40 years each before it was divided up. 40 times 3 is 120 years. He's picking that up as well.
Right.
All of that. See, that's why we can say he performed 4,000 years of people, places, and things, of works, in the space of 33 and a half years. That's why we know he is the true Messiah.
Right.
The one who Moses talked about. The ones who the prophesied testimony of. Why? Because he is the fulfillment of what they said and what they wrote. And it's that same one that is performing that same fulfillment within you. Okay? Thank you so much for your time and your patience. Please come back with your questions. You know, and we will explore this as much as we can. And with those few words, finish it off.
Okay, that concludes today's lecture. Right after 1 o'clock, 1:30 is it?
1:15.
1:15, we'll have a business meeting. Those that want to stay, can stay. It's not mandatory, but
please stay.
Well, if you want to. Okay. Now, I apologize to the first visitors, first time visitors. Sometimes my mind goes, so I have to bear with it. But yeah. All donations can be had by Dr. Eunice Reiser. We have classes here Sundays at 11 to 1, Tuesdays and Thursdays, 7:30 and 9:30. We have a Spanish class every fourth Sunday of the month, okay, from 9:30 to 10:45. Okay, is there any other announcements? That's it. Okay, don't forget that next year we're going to New Mexico, right?
This year.
November.
I told you. Forgot about New Year's. Okay. So keep that in mind. Okay. So let's all stand and be dismissed. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling and present you faultless with his presence with exceeding joy. To all wise out of him, our Savior, to Yahshua, the Messiah, sovereign, be our glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever. Let's all say,
hallelujah.
I got time.
Hope you enjoy that.
That's right, get the hugs in there.
Screw the hospitality.
Thank you.
Hey.
Just hope it wasn't in a fight. Hey, Tom, how are you doing? I want to be in the
What's up, baby?
My man.
Yes, sir.
Good stuff.
Daryl, where's my hug?
Oh,
we're
going to go
back. Thank you.
Yeah,
man. Appreciate it. I'll definitely be back. Okay.
Anytime, man. Come with some questions. Anything. We're here to help.
Yeah, ever since my dad.